Good evening, friends. This is a story of an extraordinary artist and a very powerful woman, a personality in her own right, who lived life entirely by her own terms and contributed to a legend that has its life several years after she passed away in her physical form. Unfortunately, much of what we know of Veena Dhanam are still legends only. There is very little fact. And what little fact that is there is available thanks to her grandson, T. Shankaran, who documented in brief her life. Dhanamal's lineage goes back by several generations, and the earliest ancestor, who must have been 6 generations before Dhanamal probably, is Papamal, who was a dancer in the Thanjavur court. And the ancestor about whom we have some degree of certainty is Kathamakshi of Thanjavur, who was Dhanamal's grandmother and who definitely lived in Sargodi Maharaja's time. This is 1799-98 is when he became the ruler of Thanjavur. In 1799 he was pensioned off by the British and he died in 1832. So roughly around that period she must have been in this, the court of Sargodi. When Sarabhuji died and his son Shivaji took over, Thanjavur was already waning in terms of being a power. And Sarabhuji's son Shivaji, to compound matters, did not produce a male heir. So in 1855, when he died, the kingdom was taken over under the doctrine of Nash. And by then, Madras had emerged as a very powerful center for commerce, for governance, and also for the arts, because you had the rich businessmen, the Dubashis, who knew 2 languages. And who were enormously wealthy, and they could command a number of artists to be in their dressing room. One among these was Rangoon Krishnaswamy Mudaliar, and he invited Kamakshi to come down to Madras, and they took up residence. I will show you the street where they lived. But Kamakshi, among several other things, apart from being a talented dancer, also managed to learn several compositions from several gurus, of whom one is supposed to be Subraya Shastri, the son of Shama Shastri. The family moved down and lived in what is called Natupilayar Kovil Street in Georgetown. This is one of the oldest buildings in that street, definitely not the house of Kamakshi, because this is a Bhajana madam that is there in that street. And Kamakshi, by then possibly around 35 or so, had abandoned dance and was taking to music as a career. Apparently, Kamakshi did not have children, and it is through Muktamma that I learned that Sundaram, Kamakshi's daughter, was an adoptee. She had been given away in adoption to Kamakshi by a Brahmin family that was in dire straits and could not support female children. And Sundaram was therefore taken on by Kamakshi, and she was trained in music by, among others, Annaswamy Shastri, and she also learned music from several other sources. And it is Sundaram, who had 9 children, unlike Kamakshi, who did not have any and had to adopt, Sundaram had 9 children, of whom one is this gentleman, Appa Kannan, who was a Mridangam artist. T.V. Subbarao writes that yet another brother was drowned in the river following a swimming accident. But of these people, the only ones whom we know are Dhanam and Rupavati. Dhanamal being the elder daughter and Rupavati being the younger. And singing in tandem was part of the family tradition, and there was Kamakshi and Sundaram, then Sundaram and Dhanam, Dhanam and Rupavati. They would always sing songs in tandem, and it was believed that because the music of the family was slow-paced, it required enormous breath control, and in order to obviate pauses where, you know, the song would cease so that the musician could take a breath, singing together removed those pauses and ensured continuity in the music. This is one of the theories as to why they sang together. But they were not the only singers singing in tandem. At that time, there were also the NRD sisters, Lakshmi Narayani and Randaya, who were very famous singers in Madras, whose patron was this man, Raja Savalai Ramaswamy Mudaliar, who also was a patron to the family of Dhanamal and her mother. When Dhanam was very young, the mother had been employed as a Manikatal in the house of a rich Mudaliar in Georgetown. A Manikatal is a person who prepares the puja vessels and readies everything for worship and also sings a few songs during the process of prayer in that house. And when Dhanam was very young, she was taken along one day, and the Mudaliar heard her sing and was impressed with her voice and organized for a scholarship of a, today what would be a very paltry sum, but in those days I'm sure it must have been a respectable amount of money, and ensured that she was sent to learn music formally. And she also learned the veena, which is what he stipulated. He spoke of vocal music and also veena. And she learned from a man called Araja Singarachari. Much later in life, she was to say he was neither Araja nor was he Singaram, but he taught her the veena quite well. And once she had learned the veena, she decided to part ways with this tandem singing and make the veena her partner in music. When you listen to the gramophone recordings of Dhanamal, which were done towards the end of her life, you find her singing along with the veena at several places. So it was a question of, you know, the veena and she were not different from each other. So each was an extension of the other's personality. And she used the veena to partially express her musical thoughts, and otherwise she used her voice. And so Rupavati branched out on her own as a dancer, as a singer, and much later in life settled down in Hyderabad. This is a portrait of one of the wealthiest Zubashas of Madras, Muddavenappu Dera Venkata Swami Naidu, who was the Zubash of Parry and Company. And today, many of you may be familiar with the Thamudrenu Theatre in Mayapur. That is where the family house used to be. It was not a very large house, it was only 150 grounds in extent. And the family bungalow was called Lakshmi Vilas. And towards the end of Dera Venkata Swami Naidu's life, which probably would have been around 1900 or so, a second bungalow was built on the rear, which was called Lal House, which still stands, but Lakshmi Vilas was demolished much later and became the Thamudrenu Theatre. And Dera Venkata Swami Naidu was a great patron of the art. And in his house lived a blind artist. This is a photograph of Lakshmi Vilas taken shortly before it was demolished. And this was a blind artist who lived in that house. His name was Padam Baldas Naidu, Balji Baldas Naidu. In fact, the name Balji repeats itself in the family of Venkata Swami Naidu. So probably he may not have even been a musician who was living under the patronage. He may have been a kinsman. He may have been a family member who was supported by the wealthier cousin. He was blind and he used to hang the veena around his neck and walk around performing whenever the fancy took him. This was a man who had an enormous collection of padams in his repertoire. And it is to him that Anam came to learn padams. And apparently the name that he had given her was Akipeta or Matchbox, because she was that quick in absorbing whatever he could teach her. And so today, you know, what we consider to be the padam, which is the suttu of the Dhanamal family, was something that she earned herself. It was not something that had been handed down to her by her ancestors. It was an acquisition of her own, and later, of course, she was to become famous for the rendition of these padam. She also learned songs from Tirukodi Kaval Krishnayya, the uncle of Semamburi Srinivasayya, and apparently she had a very strict code of conduct as far as learning songs was concerned. She would teach the guru one song, in exchange for which the guru would have to teach her two songs. This was the ratio in which the, you know, the stock exchange would go on between whoever she had decided to learn music from. This is like Indira Gandhi, the only man in her cabinet. This is a photograph of the Periyakatchi at the Sirvai Adityagaraja Aradhana, and you find that all of them men, and then you find Dhanamal standing right at the back with Kumbakonam Aridi and Ambipilla. At the time when women were not considered to be the equal of men in Carnatic music, even today I think that dichotomy persists. And if I may be allowed to digress a little, even today I think it's difficult to get a woman accompanist to accompany a woman vocalist. And it is much more difficult to get a male accompanist to accompany a woman vocalist. So in those days you had a very derogatory term for female music, which was Srila Patalu. Women could not do Nerival, women could not sing Kalpanaswaram, definitely they could not sing Tanam, and they could not put Talam on their thali and sing Patalim. So there was a lot of restriction on what women could do. And in that era, to be considered to be an equal of so many of these giants in the musical world was something of an achievement. Definitely all of them feared her asservic tongue, and Definitely all of them respected her musical knowledge as well. She incidentally had a term for every one of them in the sense that as far as this gentleman was concerned, that is Malakota Govindswamy Pillai, she said that when it came to appreciating music, there was none who was his equal. Similarly, as far as Tirukkodi Kaval Krishnayyar came, she believed to have said that, you know, certain ragas were entirely his property. But she wouldn't go beyond that in appreciating anybody, a woman who was extremely economical in her use of words, in her speech. The great interest in Dhanam's life came from this gentleman, Dharmapuri Subbaraya. Dharmapuri Subbaraya came from a fairly wealthy family somewhere near Salem. By the time he was born and he was growing up, the family was involved in a lot of litigation and there was hardly any money left. And he was working in a lowly job in a government department, but he was known for his repertoire of songs. And one day he pleased a visiting judge with his music, an Englishman. And when the Englishman asked him as to what is it that you want me to give you in return, he's supposed to have said, just settle this case in my favor, and that's all I ask of you. So, you know, you can imagine how that this was done in those days. So the case was settled in the favor of Dharmapuri Subbaraya. And he had an enormous amount of money and he could therefore lead a life of leisure. He came to Madras and he began to live in Georgetown. In retrospect, Subbaraya appears to have been a man who was a kind of a butterfly. You find traces of Subbaraya in several places. For instance, when B. Krishnamurti did a research project on the lives of song notebooks of the Enadi sisters. There were some javelins of Subbaraya which were in the Enadi sisters' notebook. Bengaluru Nagarathnamma had a set of songs that Subbaraya had, you know, taught her. His great, probably his romantic interest in his life was Kumbakonam Balamani Ammal, who was a stage artist of those days, and who ran a troupe of theatre artists, all of them women, who used to perform male roles as well, including rather erotic scenes for those days in the plays like Chara Satankamo and things like that, and huge crowds used to come to watch them perform these plays. And it was said that special trains would be run by the South Indian Railway Company called the Balamani Special, so that, you know, people could travel from Trichy to Kumbakonam to witness the play. Yemandune Muthu Balamani is supposed to have been composed for Kumbakonam Balamani Ammal. Somewhere along the way, he discovers Dhanamma. And as Shankaran writes beautifully, it was a great relationship of Ullasamo and Sallapamo between the two. And he was definitely to dedicate at least two songs to her. One is supposed to be Nari Mani and the other is Marasundarangani in Paras, which definitely has an allusion to it. It is structured in a fashion where the female in the relationship is speaking about the male and says that when I play the Veena, he is there to appreciate me right through. So this was the great relationship that existed between the two of them, and that was definitely to be the most prolific composing period in the life of Dhanapuri Subbaraya, and several of the javelins that he created came to be in the Dhanamal family. Another person who must have been here at this time was Patnam Subramaniayyar, and there are stories that say that the eldest daughter of Dhanamma, Periyakutti Ammal, Radhalakshmi Ammal, had actually learned music from Patnam Subramaniayyar. There was also Tiruvattiyur Thyagayyar, the son of Veenakuppaiyar, who was living just a short distance away from Dharmal's house in Ramaswamy Pillai Street. This is the house. Today it is a urinal and a garbage dump. And I don't even know whether it has survived the last monsoon. Till the prior, this is November here, it was standing. And this is where he lived. And he apparently used to walk down every day in the afternoon to play dice with Dhanam. And he taught her several of the songs, and definitely the Vegara Varnam Inthachala, which she recorded later for the gramophone, is supposed to have been polished by her to make it concert worthy, and it is said that that is the tradition that most musicians have followed later. This is the Dhanamal family shortly after grandchildren were being born. So you have Dhanamal in the middle, and you have Rajalakshmi or Periyakutti, you have Lakshmi Ratnam or Chinnakutti, Jayamma and Kamakshi. These were the four daughters. And then you have Sundar Rajan, the only son of Rajalakshmi, T. Shankaran, the only son of Lakshmi Ratnamma. Then you have got Brinda, Mukta, and Balasaraswati. So you have them all photographed. Now, looking at this photograph, you may imagine that they were all exceedingly wealthy because they are all highly visual. But when I asked Muktama, she said, "Yalla, what are they doing in the photograph?" See, Dhanamma was a prolific, you know, profligate spender. She did not believe in saving anything for a rainy day. And her taste was extremely luxury oriented in certain aspects and extremely spartan in certain other aspects. For instance, her paan supari had to come from a particular location and it cost a bomb for those days. Her perfume had to come from a particular location, once again costing a bomb. And this kind of expenditure on a lifestyle where she did not believe in going out and performing. That was the ego of Dhanamma. That was the other problem with her. Loads of talent, but if anybody wanted to listen to her music, they had to come home. She would go out and perform. So where would the money come from for maintaining such an expensive lifestyle? So there came a time when her excesses had gone far beyond what could be tolerated, and she was bankrupt. And the house had to be auctioned as well. And it is said that when she sent a letter to Subbaraya, by then his family were heartily sick and tired of the relationship, so they hid the letter. And when he got to know and he came back to Madras, everything was gone. Dhanam had, you know, shifted, the house had been auctioned, and it was with great difficulty that he traced and found out where she was living, daughters having been villages with various other villages. And then in remorse, he is supposed to have composed the Javali Sakhi Pran, which speaks of a beloved not keeping a tryst. And at the end of it, it is said that Dhanamal spoke to him and said, "I don't need any money from you. You have given me an inestimable wealth, and this is all that I require." And apparently, that marked the end of the relationship as well, because he died shortly thereafter. And she became a very moody and introverted soul, and probably fined for the rest of her life for Dharmakuru Subbaraya. A young man who was a patron of the entire family at around this time was this character, Jalasarangam Ramanaya Sethi, who lived in Sata Mutesan Street in Georgetown, the house still standing with a few family members still living in that house. A chit fund magnate of Georgetown who believed in taking care of all these odd artists who wouldn't go out and earn money on their own. He considered it to be his responsibility to take care of all of them. He would fix concert opportunities for them. He would put up with all their whims and fancies. And every year, he organized a concert on the terrace of his house during Ram Navami, when people like Kanchipuram Ganapoti, Veena Dhanamal, Bengaluru Nagarasama, and others would come and perform. And once it is said that, you know, Ganapoti had come to perform in this city, lost the money that she had been given as a fee, and then went to Ramanaya's house to perform. And he got to know about the fact that she had lost the money, and when she got up, she accidentally found the bag under her. Nobody, Ramanaya didn't tell her that he had compensated her for the money that she had lost by her performance elsewhere. Now, this was a man who steadily went bankrupt, finally protecting all the artists, giving them gold medals, taking care of artists in his house. In fact, it was called Keti Chatram by Dhanamal herself. She also lived in that house for several months on end when she couldn't get along with her daughters. Finally, Subramanya Pillai, when he ran away from home, came and lived over here. It was only after some time that they found that there was an extra person living in the house and feeding along with the rest. This is the kind of legend that you have of this Ramani city. Apparently, he was also very economical in his words, and the only thing he would say about Dhanamal's music was that it was essence. That's the only thing. That's the essence is, you know, there's no other term. It imbibes the core of Dhanamal's, I mean, the core of Carnatic music was there in Dhanamal's music. And he took care of them. And he lived, this is in fact his house, and this is the terrace on which so many immortal artists must have performed. And he found this house for Dhanamma on a rent of 2.5 rupees a month. This was sometime in 1901. This is in Ramakrishna Tethi Street. And this is really where we know the legend of Dhanam. Because this is where, you know, with the help of people like Muktama who was able to describe day-to-day life in this house, we know that every day Dhanam would get up a little late in the day, then have a glass of orange juice, and then come down at around 11 o'clock, have a bath, have a frugal lunch, and then sleep in the passageway, and prevent anybody from either going out or coming in. Nobody could do anything when she was sleeping. At around 4 in the afternoon, go upstairs, and then slowly musicians would start coming, meeting up with her. And on Friday evenings, this is where her famous Friday evening performances would take place. No question of going out to perform. take the veena and perform on a Friday evening. And everybody who knew something about Carnatic music would want to get in and sit there for some time and listen to the music. Now the staircase is very narrow, the room is even smaller. So I don't think at any point of time, maybe 25 to 30 people could have sat with great difficulty in that room. Definitely not elderly people with arthritic problems and things like that. But they all apparently sat there, abided by her condition of complete silence. If anybody sneezed, she would put down the veena and say, one concert in this room is enough. Either you continue sneezing or I continue performing. And if somebody got up in the middle, you know, and she was going blind rapidly by this time, and so somebody would whisper into her ear as to who was coming, and so she would know from the place where they were sitting as to who it was. And then it is said that Krishnacharya Kriya Srinivas Iyengar once got up because the last tram for Mylapore was leaving and his reservoir supporting fell down to the crash, and he said, only people who know music can stay behind, all the Ajnanis can leave. Imagine Krishnacharya Kriya Srinivas Iyengar being preached this way. So then, you know, you had the famous story of Ramanariya himself suddenly forgetting himself and getting carried away and putting Thalam on the ground with great vigor and gusto, and then being told the Sani Katravela and his cousin. Thalam Boradata silent up on you. So that kind of, she could terrorize audiences, but everybody abided by her terms and conditions. Govind Swami Pillai came here to listen to music, and the most moving story about Govind Swami Pillai and Dhanamal is Govind Swami Pillai's student was Baba Venkatramaya. And at a fairly, not at a very advanced age, Pillai had a stroke and became invalid, and you know, the tutelage had to be stopped for quite some time. One day he recovered and he began teaching Baba Venkatramaya, and they decided to start on Gaulai. And suddenly he stopped and said, you know, I have made a great mistake. This is Dhanamal's ragam. If at all you have to learn it, you must learn it from her. And within a week he was dead. So Papa, heartbroken, goes to meet Dhanamal to condole with her. And she said, I will begin teaching you from today. Let's start with the Raga Gaulai. It was a communion between two immortal souls, neither of them having known that the other had spoken of it. Nayana Pillai, though much younger, he was after all the nephew of her friend, Kanjipuram Dhanakoti, he would come and he learned music from Ramaneya Chetty. Ramaneya Chetty was one of his gurus, because Ramaneya's mother came from the Tilasthana Parampara, if I'm not mistaken. And he taught Dhanamal a few songs as well, on the same ratio of two songs is to one. And much later, of course, her granddaughters Dinda and Mukta would go to him to learn music. Abdul Karim and Calcutta Gohardam were the two musicians whom she admired in the Hindustani genre. And when Abdul Karim came to Madras, she would go after wherever he performed, and he is believed to have said that unless the old woman comes, I will not begin singing. So that was the kind of love and affection that they had for each other. And when the Butler Commission was coming down to South India, you know, to identify a constitutional form of government, this Talukdar of Avadh comes down, and S.Y. Krishnaswamy, ICS, takes him to meet Dhanama, because he makes a derogatory remark saying that, you know, what are the South Indian artists? If you want to listen to true music, you must come to the North. And Dhanama plays a few ragas for him, and he's so pleased that he empties his pocket. There are some 115 rupees or something, and he places it at Dhanama's foot. Now, Dhanama never believed in saving up for another day, so how to spend the money? She immediately sends for Abdul Karim and says, you know, I'd like to listen to your thing. And at the end of it, that money was handed over to Abdul Karim as a token of her appreciation of his music. Govardhan was her. And incidentally, Yetravetu Kondu Raghava and Ramani Samana Megaru are learned by Abdul Karim from Dhanama and later on recorded as a gramophone as well. Similarly, Bhajana Parula is taught to Govardhan, who, you know, the cuckoo of Calcutta, who comes in 1911 to Madras on a sensational concert tour, with a dinner organized by Dhanama, with catering by Harrison and company. Where did she find the money for this? And welcoming Govardhan with a sandalwood garland at the entrance of the house. All that is a, you know, it's only a story of legend. I don't think, you know, today it's very difficult to even believe these things. The family that really was a patron to this family was that of Dr. C. Sitapati Iyer. And this, of course, Dhanamal is not in this picture, but this is a photograph taken in the Kodaikanal house of Dr. T. Sitapati Iyer, Malakota Govind Swami Pillai, and Lakshmi Ratnamma, the second daughter of Veena Dhanama. They are both here. And it is to their children, like Savitri Rajan, that Veena Dhanama was to teach music. She was also to teach music to few others, but not many. And over a period of time, the daughters got married and settled down. Muktama, of course, gave me this photograph, and then I scanned it and put it here. This is her mother with Kasturi Ranganga's brother, who was her consort in life, and all of them as children. This is Vrindamma, Muktamma, Abhirama Sundari, and this is one of her brothers dressed as a girl in that photograph. Some of the people who became great friends of Veena Dhanamal, Tiger Vattacharya and Halkeshanalur Mutaya Bhagavatar. Tiger, it is said, and S. Rajam was the one who told me this, that when Friday evening concerts would happen, Tiger would linger for long and not go home. And at the end of it, the last tram would have already departed. He would sleep in the Dinai opposite Dhanamal's house and go home next day in the morning. Shankaran has written a very beautiful account of how these two became very close to each other. You know, they get to become very friendly rather late in life. And it is then that, you know, she meets Tiger once and asks him to sing a raga. And after some, when she's in the midst of developing the raga, she asks him to sing another raga. And then, you know, he says, "You are a rather difficult woman, aren't you?" And then he goes on to sing it, and she appreciates his music to such an extent that they become the closest of friends. Much later, at her grandson's wedding, Tiger is invited to sing. And he performs, and at the end of it, he tells Dhanama, "You know, my voice was not cooperative today. I really regret not being able to sing better." And she produces a silver bowl filled with Kalkandi to the brim and gives it to him, saying that this is my opinion of your music. And Tiger and she, the famous story is that, you know, when he sang Sahana, somebody came to him and said, "Amma vandhu vera marina paadranga." He said, "I believe, go and tell her that Ayya Pradhan paadranga." Alikudi Ramanujayengar learnt a few songs from her. He acknowledged it later to Raghu Ramanujayengar. And of course, she was not above putting him down when it is tired. When he got the title of Sangeeta Ratnakara, he goes and visits her and she says, "Anywhere the Pustaka Pairana title of Kotar Sangeeta." I don't know what she would have had to say about the Sangeeta Kalanidhi, which is also a book title, incidentally. Madras Lalitangi, the mother of Vasanta Kumari, also learned a few songs from her. In fact, the Purandara Manimala, the book that Lalitangi produced, acknowledges that Veena Dhanamal was her guru in music. But the one great interest in Dhanamal's life was Tiruvarur Rajai, the woman whom she believed would truly be her heir and representative as far as her tradition of music was concerned. And it was a shattering blow to her that Rajai died of childbirth at a very young age and did not live to carry on that promise. There is, of course, the famous story of Kosiri and Parur Sudaramayyar coming to learn music from Dharma. 1 rupee a song and two of them splitting it at 55 each. And landing up there, and of course, Pati Sri Giriraj Sute, and Musiri, out of nervousness, probably, Pati Sri, Ajire Modata Tapata Katan Vandrika, and Kapana Yavanda Pata. Snuff that the man never recovered from. This, of course, is Dhanama, taken, you know, probably in Dr. T. Sitapati Iyer's house, by then completely blind, and playing the Veena. And among the other, and the grandchildren are already growing up. Here you have Vrindamma, Muktamma, and Abhirama Sundari, their sister, at an All India Radio recording. The two of them had learned music from Naina Pillai and come back. Bala Saraswati, the other great legend, who was also her granddaughter. It was with great difficulty that the family could convince Dhanamma that Bala Saraswati could take to dance as a career. But once she had ascertained her talent, she gave permission and went ahead. Dhanamma's close friend, Nagarasnamma, there was a complete contrast in their nature. One was moody, one introverted, not believing in earning money, not going out and seeking anybody, very, choosy as far as speech was concerned, whereas this was a personality that was, you know, extroverted, plenty of patrons, enormous wealth, the first artist to pay income tax, and, given to sudden passion, projects that she would take to everything larger than life, but they were closest of friends. And Nagarasnamma waited for Dhanamma to die before she sold her house and moved to Tiruvayyar. This dedication to Tyagaraja was enormous, but the friendship with Dhanamma was even closer. Rajaratnam was the other person whom she believed would be a great talent, and he surely was. And though she did not like Nagaswaram as her instrument, she liked Rajaratnam Pillai's music to such an extent that she has even played the tambura for Rajaratnam Pillai Nagaswaram on a few occasions. There is, of course, this famous story documented by Bala Saraswati in an Indian Fine Arts Society souvenir, where she says that in 1936, when Rajaratnam Pillai was performing at the Congress Festival on General Patel's Road, Janama was all alone at home and completely blind. Then news came to her that Rajaratnam was performing on Dendrapatta's road. She was living in Georgetown. So she feels her way down, gets into a rickshaw and asks him to take her to Raipata. And on coming there, the crowds are such that she is not able to, the rickshaw is not able to make its way through. So she gets off and feels her way through, just with the music as the guide. And finally reaches the stage where, you know, people make space for her. And as the performance ends, there is a commotion because she has managed to get onto the stage. And the curtains come down just as she embraces Rajaratna Pillai in a bear hug, such being her appreciation for his performance. By then, you know, getting approval of Dhanama was very important. I'm talking about 1931-32, which is coming to the end of the last few slides. I hope I've not exceeded my time limit. By then, you know, getting Dhanama's approval in order to perform in this city has become important. So you have Madhuri Shanmuka Vadigo bringing her daughter M.S. Subbalakshmi, and Dhanama listens to her and predicts that there will be a bright future for this child. Getting approval from Dhanama incidentally was not all that easy, because there is the story of a patron whose daughter was brought. She sang Bhairavi, and then they asked Dhanama, "What is it? What do you think?" There was a long pause, and then she said, "Ananda Bhairavi." So that MS was, you know, she predicted a bright future for her, and definitely that is what happened. The youngest grandson, T. Vishwanathan, who takes him to the flute, and you know, the only thing that he remembers of her when he gives an interview to Shruti magazine is that he performed a Kaveri piece for her, and she said, "You must practice a lot, and I'm sure there will be a bright future for you." But when he sang a Javali, she supposed to have slapped him and said, "Onamari easier to Haryana and the Javali Elam Parabol." That also he himself has said in his own words. In the last few years of her life, these three young men become great patrons of her music, and they never lose an opportunity to go to her house and listen to her. This is N.D. Varadacharya, a lawyer, T.T. Krishnamacharya, his close friend, and S.Y. Krishnaswamy, the ICS officer. Towards the end of her life, N.D. Varadacharya incidentally maintains a diary. So, and that diary is now published as a book. So you can actually record his impressions of Dhanama's performances, of Aryapudi's performances, Hemamudi, on a day-to-day basis. He has listened to them. Today the old lady performed this. Today she has performed this for us. And on one occasion he said, "So sweet is her speech and so dignified is she in the way she conducts herself, that I don't think we can ever meet such a personality again." This is his comment about her. And then on one occasion he says, "Clearly she is now dying, and there are only a few days left for her." And that incidentally, the same incident, is quoted by him, and it is also quoted in S.Y. Krishnaswamy's memoirs of a mediocre man, where they all three go and she performs Natakurasi, and at the end of it, you know, these two, N.D. Varadacharya and P.D.K. tell S.Y.K., "You're the man with the way for words. Say something. And then, you know, he gets up and says, "Amma, today you have performed beautifully. Even if God and Saraswati came down, I don't think she'll be able to perform this Radha this thing." Rangaramanujayengar, who, there are conflicting claims. He said that he was a disciple. People have said that he was not. But this is a photograph that was taken of them together. Much later, he sculpts a statue of Dhanama, which he worships at his house. Much later, when that house was being demolished, Muktama made efforts for that statue to be shifted to her house. And it is now in front of the flat where she lives, that the statue of Dhanama is now standing. The family and the lady, the last 2 years of her life, this was possibly taken in 1936 or so, much expanded, all the grandchildren, the granddaughters. Finally, in 1936, till now Dhanama has never recorded her voice. But it is T.T. Krishnamachari who finally convinces her that she must get her voice recorded. So with great difficulty, she makes her way to the HMV studio, and 8 or 9 discs are recorded of her music. Unfortunately, the discs don't sell all that well, and the HMV decides to withdraw it from the range. And it is only after she dies that T.T.K. and T. Shankaran manage to retrieve whatever few records are left of that particular issue. This is Columbia, which also recorded her at the same time, her name much revered. And, you know, the last few photographs, completely blind by then, with the Vesalapaku Koti in front of her, which was the one companion that stayed true to her. Then on October 15, 1938, Dhanama passed away. N.D. Varadacharya writes in his diary that he was out of station, and when he came back, T.T.K.'s driver, who came to meet him at the station, informed him that Dhanama was dead. He says that I don't think we are ever going to see the life of such an artist again. The death incidentally did not happen at Georgetown, it happened in Egmore in Balasar Shooting House, where Ganamal had gone to visit her. And it was once again brought about by Ganamal's own excesses, in the sense that every Navratri she believed in bathing in rose water, sitting under a bower of jasmine flowers with a veena in her hand. The family would sing Veena Pustaka Dharinim, and then the formal worship would begin. Now, a lady who was not well, who was already possibly 70, I think she must have been around 70 at that time, could not have gone through this without, you know, kind of troubling her system. And she falls ill shortly after the Navratri Puja. And then on October 15, she passes away. There is a condolence meeting that is held for her at the Senate House with Rajaji, who was then the Chief Minister, Satyamurthy, K.V. Krishnaswamy Iyer, the President of the Music Academy, K.V. Subbarao, and several others participating. Once again, N.D. Vattacharya records that vocal performances were given by T. Shankaran, Brinda Mukta with Abhiram Sundari on the violin, and then Balamma with Ranganathan on the mridangam and Vishwa on the flute. So all the singing grandchildren had paid a tribute to her at the end of this condolence meeting. That really brings me to the end of this presentation. I know it ends with just a party, but I don't want to say anything because you're going through a 3-day workshop where you're going to listen to her music, you're going to know all about her style, everything. So this is just a condensed version of her life. Definitely a great woman, an outstanding personality. And of course, being a Carnatic artist is no easy job, as I keep saying. It requires enormous guts, loads of talent, and it's a very frustrating line, and I think we must always be appreciative of these people who have the courage to take to this performing career. And Ganamal was a true representative of that courage, living her life despite all odds, entirely true to what she believed were the right principles by which life should be led. Thank you so much.
May we now invite Mrs. Shanta Guhan, connoisseur of dance and music and a very dear friend of Kalakshetra, to facilitate Mr. Sriram.